First Samuel chapter 17. You know, 2 weeks ago, I felt like it was a good lesson. Maybe some of you disagreed, but we talked about Saul and really what led to him having his kingship taken from him as the king of Israel. And the title of the lesson was, "The Battle is Over Before It Starts." And yet, in a fascinating way, you have chapter 14, in which we finish the lesson with Jonathan and his armor bearer. You then go into chapter 15, in which David is anointed king of Israel. Now, at this point, no one knows about it except for David and Samuel, and you could say his family. But nonetheless, he's anointed king of Israel, and yet, in every way, he's not king of Israel in the eyes of the people. He's just literally a 16-year-old boy who he knows he's chosen by God, but what does that even mean? And yet, then you go into chapter 17, in which we're going to have our theme lesson. And so I figured, you know, what's a good title for today? Well, today's lesson is really going to be the opposite of 2 weeks ago of what caused Saul to be a bad leader. We're going to look at what made David an incredible leader. And so the title of this morning's lesson is "The Battle is Over Before It Starts, Part 2. Part 2. 1 Samuel 17, verse 1. It says, "Now the Philistines gathered their forces for war and assembled at Soko in Judah. They pitched camp at Ephes-Damim between Soko and Azekah. Saul and the Israelites assembled and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up the battle line to meet the Philistines. The Philistines occupied on one hill and the Israelites the other, with the valley between them. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out from the Philistine camp. He was over 9 feet tall. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze weighing 5,000 shekels. On his legs he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and his iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, 'Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us.' Then the Philistine said, 'This day I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other.' On hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and all the Israelites were dismayed and terrified." Now David was the son of an Ephrathite named Jesse, who was from Bethlehem in Judah. Jesse had 8 sons, and in Saul's time, he was old and well advanced in years. Jesse's 3 sons had followed Saul to the war. The firstborn was Eliab, the second Abinadab, and the third Shammah. David was the youngest. The 3 oldest followed Saul, but David went back and forth from Saul to tend his father's sheep at Bethlehem. For 40 days, the Philistine came forward every morning and evening and took his stand. Now Jesse said to his son David, 'Take this ephah of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread for your brothers and hurry to the camp. Take along these 10 cheeses to the commander of their unit. See how your brothers are and bring back some assurance from them.' There was Saul and all the men of Israel in the valley of Elah fighting against the Philistines." Wow, what an amazing scripture. It starts out and it says that the Israelites gather on one hillside and the Philistines on another hillside. So I want you to imagine just behind you that entire grassy area. And I want you to imagine a massive hill range on both sides with thousands upon thousands of soldiers on each side. And imagine not a single man standing in this grass field, and yet every morning and evening, the Bible says that Goliath would come and taunt the Israelites. I mean, what would that have been like? I mean, imagine a man 9 feet tall. Can you imagine that? I think I could. David, come on forward. It says that his spear was like a weaver's rod, and the tip weighed 15 pounds. Imagine fighting that guy. I mean, I couldn't. I can't even punch him. I can barely chin check him. Imagine that man out there every morning and every night wearing armor with that kind of a spear and saying, listen, you're a part of the army of Saul. We know what happened last time. We defeated you. Let's do this the humane way. I will fight and you pick anyone amongst your entire army. Of course, Saul was a head taller than everyone, so he would have been the natural choice. But he wasn't. He says, pick anyone you want and let's just fight. And if you kill me, then this entire army of Philistines will be subject to you. But if I kill you, then you will become subject to me. Imagine for 40 days, every morning and every night, a man of this size, not made of wooden planks, but we're talking like, probably, I don't even know what he would have weighed, 500 pounds? Pure muscle, a warrior from his youth. So we're talking like Conor McGregor, 9 feet tall. I mean, what did his armor bearer look like? I mean, oh my goodness. It definitely wasn't Sean, that's for sure. It was not Carlos, although Carlos is feisty. I mean, his armor bearer was probably Corey Blackwell's size, 6'6", 280 pounds. I mean, that was an impressive man. That was just the armor bearer. That guy, all he was allowed to do was carry his shield every morning and every night. Just imagine the humiliation that would slowly seep into the people. Of course, the number 40 is not just a random number. No number in the Bible is random. Moses went on the mountain for 40 days. Jesus was in the desert being tested by Satan for 40 days. Jesus preached the kingdom of God after his resurrection for 40 days. The Israelites traveled through the desert for 40 years. The number 40 is a number of sanctification, of purification, preparing yourself for something new. What was the sanctification? That every morning, every night, after 40 days, it became evident and apparent in every single warrior's mind. Saul is not fit to reign over Israel. Someone else must step up to fight Goliath and lead the people of God. Point number one, to survive and thrive, you need a tribe. To survive and thrive, you need a tribe. Remember, the title is The Battle is Over Before It Begins. If you don't have a tribe, you already lost. Why? What is a tribe? A tribe is a family and an army. Which means what? That we're family. Hey, look, you got me, you got Stacy. Lance would have been told at that point, but you've got Joey, you've got Nick now in the army. We're all family. And yet, when push comes to shove, we put on our armor and we are the army of our God. And yet, sadly, because of Saul's cowardice, the people had lost this mentality. The reason that Goliath had every single Israelite frozen was that they were only thinking about their own family. What about what's in my best interest? They weren't thinking for a second, hey, what's in the best interest for my buddy Sal here, his whole family? What about Bill? What about his family? They were only thinking about themselves. And so because their ideal of family was skewed, they cease to be the army of their God. See, in America today, this is the ideal situation. It's about me. It's about your own family unit. And you got just this turmoil of people that want money, don't want to give money, don't want to increase taxes, want to get rid of social entitlements, people that want more social entitlements. And it's just this battle. Why? Because no one's thinking about the well-being of the country. During the Great Depression, you know what they did? They skyrocketed the taxes to over 90%. And they created certain loopholes. But what happened? Every single American was expected to dig their hands in the dirt and flat make it happen. And yet, we live in a time now where everyone can't see beyond themselves. They're consumed with their own circumstance. I want to plant churches, but what about my finances? I want to see a church go, but I don't want to go, because what about my life? I just got this job. I just got this promotion. That supersedes the call of God. And we cease to thrive, and we can barely survive. Because we're not a tribe anymore. The three musketeers, all for one and one for all. That's a tribal mentality. That was a three-man tribe. All for one and one for all. I find it amazing because it says that we then find David. And it says that his father, who was the grandson of Ruth, you read that book, she was a Moabite Gentile. And yet it says that Jesse sends David with some grain, some bread for his kids, and then 10 cheeses for the commanders. This was amazing. They were a tribe, which means they were the family. And so Jesse sent his three oldest sons to war. That was his family. But he didn't just send them to war. He paid for them to go to war. He understood that, yes, they were a family, but they were an army. He sent his sons, and he paid for his sons. Go take the boys some of this food here so they're taken care of. He did not expect anyone else to take care of his children. He took that upon himself. Beyond that, he then sends 10 types of cheeses. You understand, cheese is a delicacy, especially during this time. And he takes it to the commanding officers. Now, understand, Jesse understood what was going on in the battle. And yet, he still had a respect for the leaders and the commanders of that army, though they were filled with cowardice. He still showed proper respect and appreciation for their roles. How counterintuitive to the way that we think. Right now, if you look on social media, how many positive things do you find about Trump or Clinton? It's only negative. You just find the negative. I love that video they found on Facebook. I hate when I find cool stuff on Facebook, because then if I share about it, everybody already knows, and they're like, oh, you stole that from Facebook. But you got the story of the teacher who writes down a bunch of math problems, and then he gets the last one wrong. And the whole classroom is laughing at him. And they go, you got it wrong. He goes, do you really think I didn't know how to do it? He said, this was a life lesson for you, that the world, though you may get 9 out of 10 problems right, they will ridicule you for the one thing you got wrong. Is that not the world we live in today? You only see negative about Trump. You only say negative about Clinton. And so what you end up having is you end up having very one-sided views of each party. Even so, even in the church today, you can find, I mean, you go, hey, tell me what's wrong about each person. Oh, a lot of just this, 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 this. Tell me what's good about them. Well, they haven't shown me anything good yet. How counterintuitive to our culture of today. And yet right here, Saul has been publicly rejected as king of Israel. Goliath, for 40 days in the morning and evening, is taunting the Israelites. Saul is trembling in his quarters. And Jesse still sends food for his kids and shows respect to him. That is how a tribe functions. And yet we can become so critical about everything. Why is this change? Why are we doing this? Why are we doing that? And of course, there's nothing wrong with being informed, but we have to be informed and yet unified. Jesse understood what it meant to be a tribe. You know, I think for us, it's a privilege to be able to send out mission teams. I mean, it's amazing, guys, that the church in Manila now is approaching 200 members. I mean, it is amazing that they had the Dubai inaugural service. Lance shared about the Tampa inaugural service. It was amazing to be able to hear about. And yet, equally amazing is the ability to continue to support those efforts. You know, I remember 2 years ago, raising money to plant the church in Manila. I gave plasma 15 plus times. If you don't know what plasma is, they stick an entire gauge needle in your arm, and then for an hour, they cycle blood out. They then cycle out the plasma, and then they put the blood back in your body, and they do that 5 times. It takes about an hour, but they pay you like $50 each time. And for Colleen and I, even though we were kind of tapped out on our own budget, we still needed to come up with $4,000. That was our personal goal. And I wasn't going to talk about it. I was going to flat make it happen. And so even Colleen, we were out there. We gave plasma. Man, we tagged. We sold stuff. We did whatever we could to hit our goal. You know why? Because Kyle's a friend of mine. He's my brother. But he's also a fellow commander in the Army. And I want to make sure he's taken care of. He's taking his three children to Manila. I think about Andrew and Patrick Smelly that we just sent to Lagos, Africa. They've already had so many people get baptized. And yet I think about his two children that he's taking. I mean, I want to make sure they're taken care of. Now, I'm not paying for him to have a lofty suite at the top floor of the nicest hotel. But I want to make sure he has a place to lay his head. He has a decent home. His kids are fed. They're healthy. They're taken care of. And I will do whatever, whenever, however, to make sure that they're taken care of. And yet, how much more us? I think part of the challenge is that many of you, you don't understand that you're a part of a tribe. This is what you know. Have you visited a church outside of L.A.? Have you gone to San Diego, Phoenix, Las Vegas, San Francisco, Sacramento, Portland, Seattle, Denver, Dallas, Texas, Orlando, Florida, Tampa, Florida now, amen? D.C., New York City, Syracuse, Toronto, Mexico City, Manila, Sao Paulo, Santiago, Chile, London, Paris, all over the world. Have you ever seen a church outside of here? If you haven't, how could you possibly believe that this is your family and your army? How can you possibly be willing to fund someone that you don't believe is going to protect you at the end of the day? See, to survive and thrive, we have to be a tribe. And I'm very excited to be able to go and visit Manila, to be able to really see what my money went to. To be able to see, wow, the souls that were saved. You know, you walk in with two mindsets. You go, huh, so this is the hotel my money went to, huh? Or you walk in and you go, wow, these are the souls that my money's gone to. These are the souls that my money has gone to. So I leave tonight at 12:30, catch a red eye over to Manila. And yet it's not without sacrifice. You know, you guys may have known Mina was due on August 30th. Of course, the Lord determines the times and places because she was not born August 30th, but nearly 2 weeks later on September 10th at 10:39 p.m. But it was an intense 24 hours, I will tell you. 27 hours. 5 p.m. Saturday night. We're sitting in the living room. Colleen jumps up. Her water broke. We go to the hospital. Her contractions have not started yet, which can be problematic. And so we go to the hospital. Her water has broken. Now they have no choice. They have to check her in. And now if her contractions don't start, they're going to have to start inducing her. And so they were so busy in the hospital, which was an amazing hospital, but they were so busy at that time that they literally had to send us into like an analysis room, where they just had a bed, and we were there from 8 to midnight. 1 in the morning, actually. And yet, from that time, Colleen did not go into labor at all. And so they started her on what's called Pitocin, which is a generic form of oxytocin, which is a hormone, a chemical in your body that, when in high quantities, starts labor. But I guess I was super unloving because it didn't work for her, so they had to give her Pitocin. Whatever. So then, it's midnight to 6 a.m., we're just trying to sleep. I find like two little chairs, I like shrivel up, I fall asleep, all right? 6 a.m., the contractions start. Now, when you look at like a pain scale, the average human can only handle about 44 on a pain level. But labor and delivery is about 55, 56 on the pain scale. Isn't that amazing? It's the love of a mother that enables a woman to handle immeasurably more than what anyone else could possibly handle in pain. Isn't that amazing? And so, but the labor starts. And going into it, Colleen was like, I don't want to have an epidural and I don't want to have a C-section. I want to do it naturally. And, you know, again, the Lord determines the times and the places, because from 6 a.m. to noon, right, Colleen went from 0 to only 3 centimeters dilated, which you got to get to about 10 before you can even start pushing. And it was extremely painful. I mean, it was hard watching her. I mean, in just extreme agony. And so at that point, she's like, I just can't do it. So they gave her an epidural, which I was glad because the pain went away. But then from noon to 7 p.m., she only went from 3 to 5 centimeters, which is not good. And only that, but Mina was a -1, which means that her head was not touching the cervix. And in order for her to dilate, her head has to hit the cervix, and then the contractions push her head, which then opens up the dilates. And so the issue is she's only halfway dilated, and Mina's head, for whatever reason, is still at a -1. And so I found out that the best nurses are from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. And so 7 p.m., everything is great. I mean, things are groovy. They're going good. And then the nurse comes in, 30-year nurse, amazing, sweet. She came the next day to see Mina. She comes in, she goes, hey, my shift's off. She's going to take care of you. She's amazing, but you could see the fear in her eyes. She's amazing. She's about 22, young girl. Within 5 minutes, she goes, she has a fever. Within 20 minutes, Colina has a fever of 102. Because her water had been broken for 24 hours, she caught an infection. But the challenge is that the infection will eventually get into Mina's system. And so, but we're trying to persevere. The doctor comes in, amazing, amazing doctor. I mean, we're so blessed. But she goes, listen, C-section may need to be a reality here. And she's trying to comfort her. And all of a sudden, because of the infection, Colleen had a fever, so Mina's heart rate had gone up to 185, 190. And once it gets to 200, it's an immediate C-section. But then the nurse didn't keep her cool because then Mina's heart rate dropped to 115 and then came back up to 185, which means that she's starting to be compromised. The nurse goes, rip the wires off. We got to get her in the surgery room. And I'm like, wow, what's happening right now? Mina's heart rate is down to 115. It's not coming up. They're wheeling her into the room, right? You gotta understand, 200 years ago, women and babies died all the time during delivery. That's a reality. And so I'm sitting here and I'm like, first of all, this nurse has thoroughly freaked me out. And so here I am, I'm sitting in this white cover suit. And I'm pale. Cause I'm thinking wow, Is my wife or my daughter gonna die? And so I walk in, they call me in. They've got this giant tarp over her head covering her body. And so I'm sitting there. She literally has her hands laid out like she's been crucified. And I'm just talking to her, comforting her. And about 10 minutes later, they pull me in out. And the anesthesiologist, great guy, timing not very good, says, hey, they're pulling her out. I look up, her head is out. And they're ripping her out of the stomach because they make as small of an incision as possible. And so Mina's face is just and I'm like, man, this just became the worst possible experience of my life. And so they pull her out and she's dark purple. And they pull her out. They immediately take her over to the table. They start cleaning her off. And you learn that babies are resilient because the guy's just flips her over. All right. But by the end of it, man, I walk over, I see Mina. I mean, the sensation of seeing your child is unexplainable. But then I take Mina out to wheel her into the urgent care. And little do I know that while I'm gone, the pain medication starts coming down and Colleen starts feeling them cutting. So she goes into shock and her body literally she passes out. But they wheel Mina into the newborn intensive care unit. They hook her up on IVs because there was a chance that she had an infection. Unfortunately, we didn't even get to have her for the first 5 days. And so we couldn't feed her for the first 2 days because she was still throwing up amniotic fluid. You know, it's just seeing her in this box was sobering, to say the least. And yet we didn't get her back until yesterday, or 2 days ago. And yet tonight, I fly out to Manila. And in every way, I would love to just stay home. But this is my family, but I'm a commanding officer in this family, which means that I have to go to war, which means that I have family. But there's a time to go to war. And even though I would love more than anything to stay, I'm going to help Tim to prepare the Global Leadership Conference that prayerfully many of you will go to. I'm going because as the director of Ignite, I want to prepare the camp for the future leaders of the movement. So yes, we are a family, but we're a tribe, which means that we're an army, which means that sacrifices have to be made. So even though I'd love to just stay home, I've got to go to Manila because I have to go to war so that we can be taken care of, so that my daughter can have a church to grow up in, so that my daughter can be a part of the kingdom, to have a worldwide movement so that I can live in my day, but she can see it, that the world was evangelized in her lifetime. And yet Jesus says in Luke 11:23, whoever's not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. Jesus understood that his identity did not come from the accusations placed upon him. Of course, his response, him saying this, was based on them accusing him of being a demon. You know, people will say what they want to say. People can say we're a cult. People can say that we brainwash people. But, I mean, in my opinion, your mind is filthy, but wash my brain all you want. People can say what they want. People can question where the money goes. People can question this. People can question that. But at the end of the day, if you're not with us, you're against us. If you're not gathering, you're scattering in every way. Look at your life. Just look at your life. Does your life embody a gathering of souls or a scattering of souls? Is there a continuity to your relationship with God or a distress to your relationship with God? See, but we're a family, which means that we are all for one and one for all, which means that this is your family, but this is your army. And we know in the military, you're only as strong as your weakest soldier. Even Paul says, 1 Corinthians 12:26, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. And I think it's amazing that Mina was born, and I felt the love. I saw Stacy on the live stream thing. Hey, we're going to send Ricky and Kalina a love bomb. I was super encouraged. But who's willing to suffer with me? Who's willing to drain their bank account to send a church out? Who's willing to stay up till 2:30 in the morning studying the Bible to help someone get baptized? Who's willing to suffer for the well-being of this family? Who's willing to be the army? Everyone wants to be the family. Everybody loves the hugs, the mamsy pamsy, lallygagging around. Oh, it's so good to see you. Everyone loves the denominationalism. Everyone loves churchianity. But we're not here for churchianity. We're here for Christianity, which means we will have a family, but we will go to war. Amen? And I think, brothers and sisters, it is time to go to war. It's time to step up personally and as a unit. But I got to ask, are you with us or are you against us? If you feel like, oh man, I feel like he's being harsh, it's because you're the person that needs to hear this. You're the person who's not a part of the tribe. And I hate to tell you, I don't want to be the bearer of bad news, but your clock is ticking. Because like a coal by yourself, you stand no chance. You need a cluster. You need a tribe of people that are your family, but they're also your army. They're willing to fight for you, for your kids, for your family. I don't want anyone in here that's not willing to fight for my daughter. You don't need to be perfect. God knows I'm not. But you got to be willing to fight for me. You got to be willing to fight for the brothers and sisters around you. And if you're willing to do that, then we can keep up and put up with the challenges that we need to grow in. Amen? Today, I'm turning in the rest of my 60%. But I got to ask you, are you with us or are you against us? You know what a reason is? It's just an excuse that you've fallen victim to. There's no reason not to be able to hit your goal. There's no valid reason. It's just It's just a lack of priority, laziness, whatever it may be. Well, how can you say that? Because if your mom or dad was in the hospital, and if you didn't come up with that exact same amount by tomorrow night, or they were gonna die, could you do it? Only the most prideful people would say no. You could do it. Why? Because it's important to you. How much more raising it in an entire month? It just comes down to priority, my brothers and sisters. Are you with us or are you against us? Here's the challenge I want to put out there. Either today or next Sunday, turn in the rest of it. You go, well, I'm not going to have any food to live off of. That's your fault. You should have budgeted. Why does God have to pay the consequence for your irresponsibility? I'm not going to have rent. $200. If you can't pay $200 for rent, how are you going to pay $1,500 of rent because you want to get married? At some point, you got to grow up and step up. And I think the time is now. Amen. The challenge is today or next Sunday, get your 60% done. It'll hurt. For some, it will hurt. It hurts me. It's painful. But it'll be worth it. Amen. See, to survive and thrive, you need a tribe. Point number two, verse 20. You know, I found that to do what we're talking about, there has to be motivation. I want you to take note of something. No one does something they don't want to do. Remember that. No one will ever do something that they don't want to do unless they have a reward, some type of motivation. For me, I promise you, in every way, I do not want to change Mina's poopy diapers at 3 a.m. But you know why I do it? Because I love her. Because raising a daughter is a reward for me. Because she's my little princess. No one does something that they don't want to do. And at the end of the day, I mean, everyone here is very intelligent. You will come up with some pretty elaborate excuses not to do what you don't want to do. Hey, this is what the scriptures teach, this is what you have to do. I mean, you will come up with some good excuses, none of which are biblical in any way, but you'll convince yourself not to do it. That's fine. Just be honest and say, I don't want to do it. Don't try and convince me to accept you for your not wanting to do what you should do. Just say, hey, I don't want to do it, and that's that. And at the end of the day, come next Sunday, if you turn your 60%, guess why? Because you wanted to. It's just that simple. And those that didn't want to, guess what you're going to have? A list of excuses. And you're going to keep going until they take it. Oh, my dog died. I had a baby. This. Oh, really? Yeah, that one. That was why I didn't get it in. Oh, I mean, that's understandable. Just, guys, we're a family. We're a tribe. We need each other. So we got to stop talking. We got to start doing. Amen? So point number two, verse 20. The bigger the risk, the bigger the reward. The bigger the risk, the bigger the reward. Verse 20 says, early in the morning, David left the flock with the shepherd, loaded up and set out as Jesse had directed. He's an obedient son. He reached the camp as the army was going out to its battle position, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines were drawing up their lines, facing each other. David left his things with the keeper of supplies, ran to the battle lines, and greeted his brothers. As he was talking to them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance. Wow. And David heard it. When the Israelites saw the man, they all ran from him in great fear. See, they all talked a big game. Every morning they drew their battle lines and then ran away. Every Sunday they got inspired. I'm going to make this happen. I'm going to change, and then ran during the week. And yet, it's amazing because right here, David comes up. He has the cheeses, the bread. He says he gives it to the keeper of the supplies, and then he just runs to the battle line. You know, within David was just a fight. David was just a warrior at heart. He just loved the battle. Yeah, it's tough. It's challenging, but he loved the battle. Do you love the battle? Do you love the grind? Yes, being up till 2:30 in the morning is challenging. Yes, sending mission teams is challenging. Yes, all the things we do is challenging, but deep inside, do you love it? Because that's the warrior inside that every one of us has to have. It keeps going. It says in verse 25, now the Israelites had been saying, do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his father's family from taxes in Israel. David asked the man standing near him, what will be done for the man who kills the Philistine and removes his disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? They repeated to him what they had been saying and told him, this is what will be done for the man who kills him. When Eliab, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the other men, he burned with anger at him and asked, why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the desert? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle. Now what have I done? Said David. Can I even speak? He then turned away to someone else and brought up the same matter, and the man answered him as before. What David said was overheard and reported to Saul, and Saul sent for him. I love this scripture so much, and yet it can be very confusing. Because the question is, where was David's heart? Well, the Bible says, at the end of the day, David was a man after God's own heart. I mean, who created these trees? God did. God loves an adventure. God loves a reward. And yet right here, David comes and he loves the battle. We talked about that. And he comes down and he sees Goliath come out. And you got to understand, these guys, it had been 40 days that they had been seeing this. And it was the first time David saw it. And so he's coming in full of faith and vigor. And he overhears them. He goes, man, after they just ran, he's like, where are you guys running from? You know, have you ever seen it when a group's running, people just kind of run with the group? or they question it? David questioned it. See, David was a shepherd, not a sheep. David did not allow his convictions, his opinions to be swayed by the public opinion. David was a trendsetter. And as disciples, every single one of us is a trendsetter. When you walk into your work, do you complain about how they curse a lot or do you put an end to it? When you walk into your work, do you complain about how they have coarse joking and look at pornography or do you put an end to it? Are you a sheep or a shepherd? Do you tend to the flock or are you of the flock? And yet right here, they're running away and David overhears them saying, can you believe what Saul's willing to do? Of course, why were they amazed? Because of all the soldiers, no one was willing to step up, not even take a chance. He says, wow, Saul is going to give his daughter in marriage to the man who defeats this Goliath. He's going to give him great wealth, and he's going to exempt his father from taxes, a.k.a. he will become royalty. It's amazing how much Saul was willing to pay for someone else to do what he should have done from the beginning. So many people are willing to pay other people to live out their Christianity. Saul was willing to make a lot of sacrifices to make his life comfortable. And yet David was willing to bring discomfort to himself to bring comfort to the people of Israel. And yet right here he comes in and he overhears them saying it. So he hears it, right? And he goes, no. It's kind of like one of those emails. It's like, get $5,000 now. He's like, let me just call and check up on this. So what's going to happen if I fight Goliath and defeat him? I go, you're going to marry his daughter. He's going to give you great wealth, and you'll become royalty, and your dad doesn't have to pay taxes. All of a sudden, his brother comes, and he's ticked. Why? He goes, you just came down to watch the battle. Yeah? Yeah, I did. You're just here because you want to be in a Bible study. Yeah, that's why I'm here right now. You're just up there because you want to get a cranking sister and get married. Well, I mean, I don't want to be single like you for the rest of my life. Yeah, I mean, I guess that is kind of part of why I'm up here. See, the heart is not only good and only evil. It's a yin-yang. It's a mix of things. And yet right here, what do you think was the thing that really pulled David the most? Your father's house will be exempt from taxes. See, David was a good son. He cared about the tribe. And yet, you got to find it humorous. David again goes and asks again. See, sadly, because his brother had been just battered by 40 days, of the Philistine coming out and 40 days of him cowering out. You know, you go out there to share your faith and you get intimidated and then you don't. You do that for 40 days straight, it will rock your faith. You get up and you know you should read the word and pray, but you choose not to. You choose to watch a little Blacklist, a little Netflix. You do that for 40 days, it will rock your faith. See, David's little brother was faithless, and that's what ticked him off. Is that here comes David full of faith and vigor and vision, the very things that he had lost. And it made him angry. You know, so often you could even see, not so much here, but because everyone's pretty fired up, but you see someone like Kenan come in just fired up and a young Christian. And then the older Christians go, just wait. You'll understand. You'll understand with time. I mean, they'll understand what it looks like to become bitter and old. You'll understand why I'm so critical. Yeah, because the spirit has departed from you, dude. That's why you're critical. And yet right here, David goes, what have I done? What have I done wrong? You know what? I'm not going to waste my time. Hey, dude, come tell me one more time. What's going to happen if I go fight that guy? See, the bigger the risk, the bigger the reward. Nothing in life worth having is going to be easy. Nothing in life worth having is going to be easy. Marriage is hard. It's hard. And I'm sorry for some of the sisters, just the attitudes that sometimes can pop up. I don't want to be unloving. You will be a terrible wife until you change that. The Bible says that the wife needs to respond to her husband as the church does to Jesus. And I'm sorry, some of you brothers can't even pay rent. The Bible says that you need to adorn and cherish your wife as Jesus does the church. You think Jesus is late on rent? You think Jesus doesn't give his contra? You think Jesus doesn't encourage his wife? I hope you don't get married. Why? Because you will make someone else suffer in the process of you learning the hard way if you don't give up. Which is a good chance of happening, and that's why you are where you are. I want to become an evangelist. Explain to me how you don't have one single Bible study. The bigger the risk, the bigger the reward. But at the end of the day, if you're going to shoot for a big reward and not be willing to lay down a major risk, which is what? Your life. Don't even try. Because you'll end up bitter. Because at the end of the day, you'll have ended up going for something that you never would have attained to begin with. You go, what if I have faith? You don't. Look at your actions. See, David was led by his faith. And therefore, he was willing to risk everything. You know, I was so fired up that even though I wasn't here, I was able to watch the two baptisms last week. I mean, it was so amazing just to be able to see Solomon baptize his older brother. And that was amazing. And all the more amazing that Angel's the one that reached out to him. I mean, that's so awesome. And then to be able to see Sean baptize a best friend from the world when we went to Cal State DH, Nick. I mean, the sharing was on fire. I heard someone cut their foot on a rock over there. That wasn't good. And yet, you know, I was very inspired because Sean, in a lot of ways, he reminds me of David. You know, Sean he's very ambitious, but you know, more so than many of the people that I know, he really cares about people. He genuinely cares about people. Even just to give you an example, last week I was going to preach this lesson and have this here, but then I obviously didn't, and I totally forgot. Sean texts me 8 in the morning, hey, bro, do you want that thing here today? I was like, oh, yeah, I do. He goes, okay, good. I called Mario and made sure he brings it. Right? And thank you to Mario for making it. Is this cranking or what? I don't want to hinder your faith with it being right there. Just make sure you take it down. Amen. That's right. Just leave it there. It needs to stay down. And I cut its head off. You see that? That's how the story goes. But, you know, in a lot of ways, I mean, Sean reminds me of David. And he's becoming much more ambitious and much more, he's gaining that vigor and that ferocity. But I just appreciate his heart. And yet I believe in every way that Nick came to service two Sundays ago, came to Labor Day, and yet then that next Sunday he got baptized. See, that, what is that? That's somebody who cares about your soul. Somebody who pushes you past discomfort. Someone who's willing to stretch where you're willing to go. You don't teach someone how to be a disciple and then not talk to them for a week. You teach them how to become a disciple and then you talk to them every single day. Why? Because if they want it, you want it. And I appreciate that so much. And yet what I love about both young men that got baptized is that it was family and friends. There's no better feeling than baptizing your best friend or a family member. I remember baptizing my sister. I remember baptizing friends that I grew up with. I remember baptizing my mom. There's no better feeling. And yet, when are you going to baptize one of your friends or family members? Who's it going to be? I think it's so awesome. We have Badia, who's James' mom. I mean, there's nothing more awesome than family. We have the Ibarra clan. I mean, it's amazing. And in 13 to 15 years, Mina will get baptized. But I want to put us on a campaign for the rest of the year that actually Sean gave me the idea for. That's why I mentioned him. It's called the Thirsty 30 campaign. He's fired up. It's the Thirsty 30 campaign. What is that? That by the end of the year, we're going to have 30 additions in the South. But it's only going to happen if you're thirsty. I'm thirsty. I'm getting cotton mouth up here. I'm thirsty. Are you thirsty? Are you thirsty? The Thirsty 30 campaign. What will that do? That'll make us the third region to be 100 members by the new year. And here's what I tell you. If I stick around long enough, we'll become the first region to hit 200 members. But here's the deal. We got to be thirsty. Are you thirsty? We've got the next 3 months to be able to go after it. I'm here to tell you, it's not going to be easy. It's actually going to be very hard. It's going to be challenging. All of us have to step up in a big way. But hey, the bigger the risk, the bigger the reward. And to start us out next Sunday, we have our Bring Your Neighbor Day. And so here's what I want to give you. I want to give you in the study, we have the 3E challenge. I'm going to give you the triple F challenge. Friends, family, and foreigner. Next Sunday, I want to give you a challenge. Every single one of you to have a friend come out to the Bring Your Neighbor Day. To have someone in your family come out to your Bring Your Neighbor Day. And to have a foreigner come out to Bring Your Neighbor. Not like a Chinese guy or... No. Someone that you don't know personally. Someone maybe you meet at the mall. Somebody you met on campus. Someone that you don't necessarily know on a personal relationship. But guys, if every one of us were to do the triple F challenge, we would have over 200 in attendance next Sunday. But are you thirsty? Are you hungry? The Hungry 100. Oh, the Thirsty 30 and the Hungry 100. What do you think, Stacy? Matthew 5, verse 7. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Booyah! Are you thirsty? Are you hungry? Not yet. Not yet. But you will be. You will be. And so, but here's the challenge. Bring a friend, family, and a foreigner. Someone you don't know. But you want to know what's going to happen? Some will not bring friends and family. You know why? Because in your mind, the risk of them persecuting you is not worth the reward of them becoming your brother or sister in Christ. See, the risk is worth the reward. Are you willing to lose the relationship to save their soul? Or are you going to save the relationship but lose their soul? See, I think the challenge is easy, guys. We got the Thirsty 30, Hungry 100. I like that. I came up with half of it, Sean. It's group work right there. But then we got the triple F challenge for our Bring Your Neighbor Day. Bring a friend, family, and a foreigner. Amen? Amen. Let's finish out the rest of the text here. Verse 32. I'll be gone for a whole week, so I got a lot to say. Verse 32, it says, David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You're not able to go against him, against this Philistine, and fight him. You're only a boy, and he has been a fighting man from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep." Not impressive, but here we go. "When a lion or a bear came and carried off the sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine." Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried to walk around because he was not used to them. "I cannot go in these," he said to Saul, "because I'm not used to them." So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with the sling in his hand approached the Philistine. Wow. Point number 3, practice makes perfect, but it takes a team to achieve your dream. Practice makes perfect, but it takes a team to achieve your dream. Right here, David had to be the all-star, but in every way, as you read forward, the rest of 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel, David in every way was a team player. David led the people of Israel to the height of the kingdom. And yet right here, David understood one simple practical. Practice makes perfect. It's amazing because David comes to Saul, and here's Saul. I mean, man, this guy's a heavy hitter. I mean, he's a real deal, no matter how cowardly he was in the moment. He was a head taller than everyone. You know, so just imagine Tim Kernan and imagine Yaman coming up to him. There's a natural intimidation that takes place if you're ruled by what you see and not by who you see. And yet, he says, "Do not let anyone lose faith on account of this Philistine." He goes, "This is no problem, Saul. I got this. It's in the bag." And Saul goes, "You can't fight him. You're only a boy." This validates that he was a teen. Why? Because 20 years old was the age of a fighting man. Now, David doesn't say you're not quite a man. He says you're a boy. So, in all reality, David was probably about 15 or 16 years old. And Yaman's 17, so he was even less than Yaman. So you got to imagine, imagine Saul, we'll just say Tim Kernan for now, and Yaman. Never fought with a sword in his life. And yet, David's faith, his zeal, his vigor was so inspiring that Saul allowed him to fight. Isn't that amazing? And yet then, in the most loving way possible, Saul, looking out for David's best interest, puts his own armor on him. Now understand, this is the king's armor. It's the best armor Israel has to offer. And Saul says, "Listen, I want you to wear it." But at the end of the day, what's the problem? You can't win playing defense. Unless the other offense is really bad, in which this one is not. It was 9 feet tall, 15-pound spear tip. You can't win playing defense. And yet, in the most loving way possible, Saul put his faithlessness onto David. In all reality, all Saul was trying to do was prolong the inevitable, and hopefully David gets lucky. And yet David, he understood one simple practical. I can't fight in these, because this is not who I am. It's not who I am. So he takes them off. It says that he gets his staff, his sling, and you know he was humble at this point because he got 5 smooth stones, not one. See, David had a plan A, a plan B, a plan C, D, and E. Some of you guys are working on plan A. You got to get to plan E. So David understood. He was ready for a fight. But he understood that his strength was not his muscles, but his swiftness. That he was light on his feet. He was quick. And so David was not afraid to fight based on who he was. You know, and I think a lot of times, guys, we can look at life and go, you know, I just got to take the safe option. But the problem with safe is that safe is your opinion. Because in my opinion, safe is the worst idea in the world. To invest anything less than everything you have is not safe. It's not safe for me. Safe is an opinion. And yet right here, David didn't play it safe. We can't play it safe because that's not how God does it. We have to fight with faith and know that it's God who's going to fight for us. But you look at David's confidence. He says, I've fought the lion. I've fought the bear. I mean, I've never fought a lion or a bear. I've seen one in a zoo. I've seen one. And yet what's amazing is he goes, when they took a sheep, I went after it. I can understand fighting for your life, but to engage it, like to pursue the lion into its own territory, to pursue the bear into its own territory. He says, I struck it down and then I took the sheep out of its mouth, meaning that it may have already been dead, but for David, it didn't matter. You don't mess with my sheep. You may have took their life, but I will take yours. And right here, he goes, Goliath, he will be like one of these Philistines. I may die, but he will die. Because he's defied the armies of the living God. Wow. He goes, he doesn't need to approach me. I will approach him. He will not run from me. I will kill him. See, David was a man of faith. And he understood that he wasn't going to play with his problems. He had to kill him. Sometimes we play with our sin. You ever done that? You don't want to be impure, but you listen to impure music and watch impure TV shows? Apparently, 1 + 1 = 3 in your life. You want to go after being able to be more responsible, but you don't have a budget, nor do you ask for help, nor do you tell anyone when you're struggling. You play with sin. Right here, that's not what David did. David cut it off. He killed it. He cut it at the root. See, we have to have the same mentality because we will have Goliaths in our lives. And you may want to fight Goliath, but my encouragement to you is just kill the bear first. Just kill the lion first before you take on Goliath. Because Goliath, he doesn't kill bears and lions. He kills warriors for fun. See, each and every one of us, guys, you were crafted by God to be your own soldier, to be your own hero, your own warrior. You have Goliaths in your life that no one else can slay for you. Only you can slay. But oftentimes we can look at our lives and we look at someone else's victory and we go, man, if only I had that, then I would be successful. No! It's not what they have that makes them successful. It's what you need to have that makes you successful. God made you just the way you are. You don't like your crooked nose? God gave it to you. You don't like your pinky toe? God gave it to you. You don't like your laugh? God gave it to you. When Mina was born, it was something that I felt terrible because I was like, that's my child? Because her face was super swollen. And I felt like this fear. It was like this detach. I was like, man, like, this is not right. Like, that's my child? Like, and now I look at her, and for sure she's my child. I didn't see Colleen. I didn't see myself in her. I didn't see going. And yet, sometimes we look at ourselves that way. We go, I'm a son of God. I'm a daughter of God. And then you get insecure about the way you look or something about yourself. So then what do? You look to people to validate it. You dress up real nice to get approval from men. You try to be funny to get approval from women. Instead of understanding, wow, I am the way I am because God made me this way. And the only way I'm going to slay my Goliath is not by putting on Ricky's armor. It's not by putting on Stacy's armor. It's not by putting on Colleen's armor. It's not using Lance's sword. I got to craft my own sword. I've got to fight my own battles because my Goliath is unique to me and I have to kill it. You know, I think last week it was amazing. Megan Matthews was here. That was inspiring because Megan Matthews had a challenging last 5-6 years. Megan's been a disciple since the 80s. I mean, her and Lance have been around about the same amount of time. So, long time. And Gainesville. In the southern Florida area, right? So that's kind of cool. But Megan's had challenges. Megan moved to Portland when the ICLC fell apart in the early 2000s, and she moved there against her will with her husband. They moved to Portland. Great things were happening. Then the LA Church was planted here in 2007, and then sadly, the relationship fell apart. There was unfaithfulness, and they separated. And she separated from him. And so, I mean, here you are, an older woman, single now. What do you do with your life? Well, one of the sisters Megan was very close to was Helen Sullivan. And so she literally moved down to Santiago, Chile, where Helen was at, and she caught the virus. She said, I want to become a women's ministry leader. So many people would have said, you're not married. And yet she said, it doesn't matter, because I've got my sling, I've got my five smooth stones, and I can defeat my Goliath. And so she trained. She was appointed a women's ministry leader. She came back to L.A. She co-led the Southland region. It exploded. She then came up to Portland with Colleen and I and helped out. But then she went on the mission team to plant Sacramento. And then recently she came down here to co-lead the West region. And she's doing an incredible job. And yet for Megan, she had to use her own weapons. She had to craft her own skill. And yet you're the same way. And the only way you're going to get there is understand practice makes perfect. But it takes a team to make the dream work. You need people in your life. You know, a brother that I'm very, very proud of, he as well has a very interesting story. And he was baptized in a church that had just been split in half under a leader who had never been trained and actually didn't have a desire to go in the ministry initially. But he was the only one that was even half talented enough to lead it. And so he was baptized while that brother was leading the church. And then a short time after, that brother then left to move here to LA to train for the ministry and put his much more introverted as well untrained little brother in charge of the church. And then time went by, it had grown, but then that brother was then taken to train further. And so then this poor brother here is here in the campus. And so then the original brother that had baptized him asked him, hey, why don't you come to LA and train for the ministry? And so he moved to Los Angeles, and he had some dreams in his heart and some desires and goals. And so he trained for the ministry. And then it came up that he was asked to be a campus intern in a church in another country. And so he went with dreams, aspirations, goals, desires, but things didn't quite lead the way he had thought they would. Right? Oftentimes we think we're Dorothy on the yellow brick road, but it's not. You start at the dark, scary forest with lions and what is it? Lions and tigers and bears. Oh my. You got to go in there. You got to kill them. And then Goliath is waiting in front of Emerald City before you can go in. And so he goes but it was challenging. There were challenges. And so he moved back here to LA, and he came to the South, and it's been amazing being able to work together and train him. And really a lot of it has just been really being able to help him build a foundation in which he's going to be able to build so that he can achieve his dreams to become an evangelist. And I'm very proud of him. He's grown so much, and yet he's grown so much that when Kirk and Margie went to Las Vegas, I thought, man, they really need a right-hand guy to lead the campus. And so on October 2nd, Stefano will be placing membership in the Las Vegas church. And so he'll be training with the ministry, and he'll be the right-hand guy there on the campus. And I believe that, without a shadow of a doubt, amazing things are going to happen, and his dreams will come true. And yet a lot of it is that Stefano just had to take ownership and just go, okay, when he first arrived, he go, bro, I just don't know if I can be an evangelist. Do you think I can? I go, bro, I'm not going to tell you that. Because if I tell you you can be an evangelist, but you don't really feel it, then I will be pumping energy into you, but you're not going to respond. And it was hard. He asked me like 15 times in the car ride. He's like, I mean, I get that, but do you think I can? I go, I'm not going to tell you, bro. You got to tell me if you can. And then I'll help you to make it happen. And so he went after it. And now he wants to go after it. He wants to be an evangelist. And I believe with all my heart that he will become one should he choose to invest everything he has. Amen? I love you, bro. And so I think it's time for us guys, though, to close. It's time for us to start looking at what we or those around us aren't. And it's time to start looking at what we are and utilizing our strengths. It's time to be dangerous and stop taking the safe option. It's time to take risks. It's time to give it all we have. You know, I think we oftentimes want to take the safe route, but I think the challenge for us guys is that the safe route leads nowhere. It leads to Candyland, and no one wants to go to Candyland. My challenge for you is, what is your biggest strength? be humble about it. Hey, this is something that I'm good at that other people don't have. I want to encourage you to use that to serve and encourage your Bible talk this week. What's your biggest weakness? Be humble. I want you to ask each of the people in your Bible discussion to show you, help give you a scripture to help you grow in that area. See, because you got to focus on the positive, but you've got to grow in the negative. Because everyone has flat sides, and you just got to try and curve those off so that they don't stop you from being able to grow. And I think, guys, each and every one of you has strengths that this region needs. If you're visiting, we need you. Dig into the scriptures. Study the Bible. You go, I already know the Bible. Pretend like you don't. Study the Bible like you've never studied the Bible. Like you've never, what's the Bible? The Bible? What is the Bible? That was German and Spanish right there, so you know. What is this thing? Study it like that. Don't bring in your baggage of preconceived notions. Study it and go, okay, what does this teach? Just pure biblical context and see where it takes you. It's going to take you for a ride. It's not going to be It's a Wonderful Life after all, right? It's going to be like X2, 360s, up, downs, all over the place, only 3 minutes later and your hair is moving in every direction. It's going to be the ride of your life. But you've got to get on. And you've got to be willing to give it everything you've got. Amen? So please, study the scriptures. You know, I'm not going to tell you what happens after this. Of course, David comes up to the battle lines. Maybe you read it, maybe you haven't. But I'm not going to tell you what happens. Why? Because you should already know. Because the battle was over before it even started. You should already know. The battle was over before it even started. But I do want to finish with Revelation 12, verse 11. I figure that this is our war story. Verse 7. It says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray, and we know that's the case. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, now have come the salvation and the power of the kingdom of our God, and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and to the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury because he knows that his time is short. Right here, Satan tried to fight against God, but he couldn't win because the battle was over before it started. Evil cannot triumph over good, no matter what the circumstance. And yet there's a war, and it says that we as the sons and daughters, as disciples, we overcome Satan by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus died on the cross. It was over before it even started. But the word of our testimony. You just got to know your why. Jesus died on the cross. That's why you do what you do. That's why you pour out every last ounce, every last drop of blood, sweat, and tears, because Jesus died on the cross. And you want everyone to have that. And yet we have to come to a realization that what is our testimony? Our testimony is that we are the princes and the princesses of our God. We are the family of our God. We are the army of our God. We are the kingdom of our God. We cannot be stopped, only distracted. The battle is over, so let's get started. Thank you. To God be the glory.